chapter 3, grouping notes, and we're going to work on the last note, which is the switch note. And after that, we will go into viewing and navigation. We'll look at binding operations. But for now, let's get started with switch. Okay, so the switch note. Again, it's a grouping note, can have lots of children, but it treats its children in a special way, and that is it only selects one of the children. Or optionally, you can have it select none of its children. Okay? And so, as with most things in X3D, we don't count starting at one, but more like mathematicians, we start counting at zero. So the initial child is called the zeroth child, second child would be called index one, and so on. And the sentinel value for which choice would be negative one if you want no children. Okay, and so this is pretty helpful actually as an authoring tool because you can use it to show different things. You can use it for animation, as we'll see shortly. You can also use it if you're testing out different versions of your content. You could look at it as sort of as a fancy comment block. Often when you're developing, you might want to say, well, let me try it a different way. And if you try to comment out a big chunk of XML in your X3D scene, that might work perfectly well. However, it might also be very bad if you have other comments in that block. You can't wrap a comment around a comment because then the XML parser stops halfway and says, oh, you just terminated the comment, and then the other half of the outer comment is garbage and it fails validation. Okay, so if we instead give something a switch node as its parent, we can comment that block out. Okay, so, but primarily we use it for animation. Now we haven't done animation yet. That's covered in detail in chapter 7, but we're gonna show you some example animation in this chapter, give you a sort of a sneak preview, and also show how we can animate a switch node to make it interesting. Okay, so here's our example on this. This example is also called switch. And it's in the chapter 3. So let's jump out to that. And I'll get rid of some of the extra stuff here so that doesn't interrupt us. And here we go with the switch node. Okay, switch.x3d, and we can see that yes, this was in chapter 3 grouping, and there it is. Okay, and our most noticeable thing right now is the XJ3D window. Hey, it's moving. It's varying. In fact, it's flipping through a bunch of shapes. So what's that about? Well, let's take a look. And we'll kill that for the moment and go to our scene graph and look at that thing and say, all right, there's our switch node. And it has 1, 2, 3, 4 shapes in it. And if we look at those shapes, we can see we have a box, a cone, a cylinder, and a sphere. Box, cone, cylinder, sphere. And a very simple scene then. Apparently the switcher will only show one at a time, and we want to flip that switch through its various values. Okay, so to experiment with this, let's first turn off the animation. And so I'm going down to line 48 where we have a time sensor. That's our clock, that's our timer. And I've changed the enabled from true to false. Okay, and then let's reload this guy. I'll have to bring the window back up, XJ3D viewer. Here it is, and we see the box, and okay, come on you. Let's force the issue here. Just gonna reload it and see what happens. And that's not so pleasant. Let's try launching it externally. Okay, here we go. And we have our switch now and launched in the external XJ3D browser, which I independently downloaded and installed. Okay, so notice that this time it's not moving on its own. So what can we do here? Well, the switcher started out with choice equals zero. So let's look at that element and edit it. And the switch says, all right, it's gonna give us a which choice, and it's going to give us a bounding box and bounding box center and size, like the other grouping notes. So we can ignore those and say the which choice, yeah, let's look at the different choices. So zero was the first, then one is the second, and here's our change, which choice equals one. So this time we expect to see a cone. Let's restart that guy, so I'll save it and go back out to the externally launched and reload it, and there's our cone. Okay, and I think you could see that those should work for each of those. For Ken, for the scribe today, why don't we add a feature request here? Right now, our which choice is just a type-in value, but the editor ought to be able to say, well, how many children are there right now, and offer you a drop-down list. So you can just select the right number of values from the list. That will also prompt you to have a zero as the first one. Maybe we'll even add a negative one as another option in the drop-down list. Okay, so please add that, and then we'll turn that into a bug later on and add it. Of course, you always wanna be have a little bit of a light touch when we're building this editor. So a check question we always ask is, if the user's in the middle of building some larger scene, we don't want the tool to get in their way and say, hey, I'm smarter than you and you don't have more than four children, so I'm not gonna let you type a seven in there. That would be bad. So what we'll do is we'll offer a menu of choices, but also let it be overridable. So if the author is in progress of building something larger, they can go, yeah, this is what I really want. Okay, so that's what we're going to do on the which choice. Instead of testing two, let's test the negative one right now and see that that works. We'll check validation. Sure enough, that worked. We'll save it. We'll go back out to the browser. We'll reload. And we're looking for nothing. And there it is, we got it. Okay, blank scene. So the geometry just disappeared. Now, conceivably, we could be looking at white geometry in front of a white background, but I doubt that. And we can shift a wireframe and not see anything. Let's check this back now to a proper value. Instead of using the editing pane, I'm going to use the editor and just type in. So I'm going to hit space, and it immediately prompts me, oh, what attribute do you want? Well, we want the which choice attribute. Select. It helpfully puts in the quotes and the equal sign, and now we can put in the number and save and refresh. And sure enough, there's our third element in the array. Okay, so switch is pretty straightforward. Now we talked about if you wanted to comment something out, you could add a switch to its parent. So let's try doing that. Let's add in a shape node here. And correction, before I do that, I'll put in a transform. Let's put a transform in. So this is off to the side a little bit. Why don't we make it 2 meters above? Okay, so, and then under that transform, I'm going to put in a shape node. And that shape node, we don't have to set bounding box, so that just goes in. The shape helpfully gives us defaults for everything. So let's drop in some text now, something different that we didn't have before. And the string can say, hide me, please. And we'll just leave that with the default gray material. But we'll leave in one of the comments and say, here is a test comment. Okay, so let's save it and re-render now. And once it's re-rendered, I may have to back out a little bit to see it. Where'd my text go? One feature in XJ3D is the Fit to World button. Okay, so it looks to me like we're not seeing it for some reason. It right up front. It could be that because I didn't have an appearance and a material that it got messed up, so I should not have deleted that. So let's put that back in. Okay, and we'll just leave the default material in rather than taking it out completely. That's a better thing to do. And it should come up gray. So let's re-render now. I'm going to go to yet another browser. See if we can't get this thing to show up. Now my goal here is to set us up with some geometry that we can hide under a switch node. Okay, so there we go. We back out and we're seeing that text to hide. Next thing to test is, well, could we comment out that stuff anyway? And so let's add a comment in there. And we'll add it just around the shape. And type hide the shape. And then I'm going to take the end of that comment, cut it and paste it after the shape. Okay, so right off the bat, we have a visual indication from X3D Edit that we're doing something that's not quite right. Because see how the comment worked here right up until it hit another comment, and then it didn't give more comment, but actually there's a little underline there, red, indicating that there's a problem. If I try to check the validity of this, we see, oh, look at that. The string dash dash is not allowed within comments. Why? Because it looks like it might be another comment starting. If we tried validating against X3D, we get the same error. Okay, so there are different ways around this. If we try to just get rid of that comment, we'd still want to keep the stuff there. Now, by getting rid of the XML part of the comment, finally, you can see that everything's grayed out. But then when we want to restore it, it's not so easy, because you'd have to restore the comment brackets around that. If you have a lot of comments, if it's a big block of code, this is pretty tedious, and it won't work. Okay, so I hope that illustrates why, yeah, you don't want to edit your comments, but rather you want to get rid of, hide, the thing that you were working on. Okay, so let's try something new on here, a new feature. I'm going to click on the transform and shape that we're trying to hide, and now we should find, there we go, a menu item, enclose the element under the cursor inside a parent node. Okay, so I'll click on that, and it says, all right, you want a new parent? Fine, tell me which one. So we'll scroll down the selection, and we'll go, okay, there it is, switch. Okay, switch node, default choice, -1, yep, that's what we want here in this case. Save it. Okay, now when we look at this construct, we can say, all right, I've got a switch. Oh, look at that, my which choice -1 disappeared, because -1 is the default value. So it stayed terse about it, but there it is. And now when we save and re-render, looking at it in instant reality here, reload, okay, going out, and sure enough, the text is hidden. Okay, so that's how we use the switch node as a commenting device. This is also a good time to flag the biggest danger of switch, the biggest warning, which is, that looks pretty nice right there, right? It's a grouping node. As a single child, you would look at that and go, well, of course that will render for me, right? No, because the default value of which choice is -1. So we want to get in there, and if only by reflex, re-edit that to say, give me my zeroth child. Okay, so that's the gotcha. Every time you touch switch node, be sure to say, oh, let's reset that to 0. Now, you might well ask, why on earth did they pick a default that hides things? Well, that is a good question. This stuff is built by consensus. We did choose that value way at the beginning. The decision criteria for defaults usually is what yields the fastest performance. So setting that up as a -1 certainly is the fastest graphics performance. It's hard to render anything faster than a lack of polygons. It sort of reminds me of the story about that new world-class supercomputer that's so fast it can complete an infinite loop in 15 seconds. Have you guys heard? No, okay. Well, I'll let you think about that one. But yeah, so maybe it's not that good a default, but there it is. That's what we have. So please don't get bitten by that. Okay, finally, we promised a sneak preview of the animation in here. So I've stripped out that extra text completely. I want it to reformat, so I'll go select all, and then where is it here? Format. And there, X3D Edit is nicely straightened out my tree for me again. And then we'll go back down here and we'll turn back on the clock and say enabled equals true. And let's look at this guy again, reloading. And we can see it switching right here among each of the children. So as a sneak preview then, let's take a look at these nodes and see what we have. Time sensor is a clock. Integer sequencer is pumping out values. It's pumping out a sequence of integers that go from 0 to 1 to 2 to 3 and back to 0. So it's cycling through those. And it does that at intervals of 0.25 of what its clock cycle is. Okay, so, and then we have a couple of routes which are hooking up one node to the other. And so what the routes say is, let's hook up my clock, the timer, to fraction changed, and my counter to set fraction to launch it. And okay, there's the validator confirming that we're still okay. And so what we have is an event channel that this starting clock drives this integer sequencer, and then that integer sequencer gets routed back to the switch node. Okay? So you can simply say on this one that integers are getting pushed into that switch node one after another at 2 second increments, and the switch node then switches among childs 0, 1, 2, and 3. And then it repeats 0, 1, 2, 3. Okay, there's the switch node. Let's see if we've overlooked anything. Back to the slides. Okay, there's our switch node laid out. It's also showing the time sensor, and there are our tooltips. Okay, so we're done with switch, and we're done with grouping nodes. Let's see what's left in here. What's left in here? Here's a couple of additional resources. We do have some grids, some grid examples we'll look at another time in the authoring tools, but I guess we can jump there right now. I'll click on the Savage examples. It pulls it up. If we go to grid example 20 by 20 movable in the XY plane, that's one. You can see there's one in each. Let's just go to the simplest one here, grid XC example, and that is too much for Vividi, I guess. Let's get our picture. Okay, time for another plugin, I guess. We can't use that one anymore. I'm looking for screen snapshots, but not seeing it. Let's do a test and see if instant reality can handle it or not. I know that contact can handle it. Nope, forget about it. I'm going to skip this section. Jeff, we're going to have to delete that block. I'm sorry about that. I should have checked that one. Okay, so repeating, additional resources. We have some grids in X3D example that are simply X3D line meshes that you can inline into your scene and put that next to your geometry to help you place it, scale it, orient it. If you really want to study level of detail in detail, then there's a good book on this, LOD. And in fact, one of the primary authors, Martin Reddy, was a major contributor to X3D, particularly in the geospatial, geothermal component. Okay, summary in the chapter. We looked at different grouping nodes, at least the first set of them. Group and transform group are the ones we used most often. Inline pulls in other content. LOD is for different versions of the same thing, selecting based on performance. Switch is different versions of different things when you only want one of them. As you use these nodes, you'll find you use them very often in combination with one another. They're not just commonly used, but they're commonly used together. So for example, if your switch was going among multiple submodels, it's quite likely that each submodel itself would start with a group saying, here's all the geometry, all the shapes I care about within me. Looking ahead to the next chapter, once we get through binding nodes, viewpoint, and navigation, we'll then go over anchor, billboard, and collision. Okay, so here are the X3D exercises that are recommended. Just put some shapes together. Translate, rotate, put them into a little scene. You might then want to try multi-fidelity, multi-resolution versions, meaning a really good one, and maybe a okay one, and maybe a dirt simple one, a box or a sphere, and then finally, not a one, a world info is an empty node. Finally, using switch is a good authoring technique, and we facilitated that in there. We've got the usual references for the book and for the resources page, for X3D Edit, the authoring hints, and then finally, these are the pertinent chapters in the Vermal Sourcebook. All excellent examples in there, and definitely worth your time to look at and work on. Okay, and that concludes the grouping chapter.